In this lecture, we'll learn about what halo stars can tell us about the history of the Milky Way and our understanding of how our galaxy formed. To sort out the history of the Milky Way, astronomers have looked at the differences in the different populations of stars. A correct model of galactic formation should explain the properties of stars that we observe, in particular, how they move and what they're made of. You may recall that astronomers divide the Milky Way into two stellar populations, the disk population and the spheroidal population. The disk contains both young and old stars, and all the stars in the disk contain a greater concentration of heavier elements. Astronomers say these stars are metal-rich, even though we're talking about elements that aren't necessarily metals. Apologies to any chemists out there. The second population is the spheroidal population. It contains stars in the halo and bulge. These stars move in highly elliptical orbits with random orientations. They are very old and have a smaller concentration of heavier elements. It's in the halo that we find globular clusters like the one shown here. These are clusters of tens of thousands of stars, sometimes a million stars, confined into an area of about 100 light years in diameter. The lack of heavy elements indicates that they must have formed early in the galaxy's history, before many supernovae had exploded and added heavy elements to the star-forming clouds. The halo has lacked the gas needed for star formation for a very long time. All the Milky Way's cool gas settled into the disk long ago, and the only stars that still survive in the halo are the long-lived low-mass stars. Any more massive stars that were once born in the halo died long ago. In the simplest model of galactic formation, our Milky Way began as a giant protogalactic cloud of hydrogen and helium gas. Halo stars formed first as gravity caused the cloud to contract. Early on, gravity drew in matter from all directions, creating a cloud that was blobby in shape with little or no measurable rotation. Localized regions within the cloud contracted and fragmented, just as in present-day star-forming clouds. As a result, the stars that formed early on could have had any orientation. This explains the randomly oriented orbits of stars in the spheroidal population. Later, the remaining gas settled into a flattened spinning disk as it contracted under the force of gravity. Collisions among the gas particles averaged out the random motions, leading them to acquire orbits in the same direction and in the same plane. Stars that formed within the spinning disk make up the disk population of stars. Studies of the Milky Way and other galaxies support the general outline of this galaxy formation model. All available evidence confirms that stars in the Milky Way's halo are indeed very old. The proportion of heavy elements is also much lower in halo stars than in disk stars. Nevertheless, this model may be a bit too simplistic. It's possible that the galaxy resulted from the merger of smaller star systems that formed from multiple gas clouds. We find variations in heavy element proportions suggesting that the Milky Way's oldest stars formed in relatively small protogalactic clouds, each with a few globular clusters. The systems of gas and stars later collided and combined to create a single galaxy, the Milky Way. Astronomers have observed that many other galaxies experienced similar collisions early in their history, and the Milky Way itself is still adding small numbers of stars in similar processes. Evidence also indicates that after the Milky Way's disk was in place, the star-gas-star cycle gradually increased the disk's heavy element content. This star-gas-star cycle has been operating continuously in the Milky Way's disk ever since it formed, and we expect star formation to continue in the disk as long as enough gas remains within it. That's all for now. Take care, and I'll talk to you soon.